We have here a PowerPoint. We are not going to watch it because there are 36 slides, or we're going to see something, because when they say me, you, the topic is what means to be human. Okay, it's a good topic, but it's not something that you can resolve in an evening talk of 20, 40 minutes that we have here. But we can grab some ideas. The point is that we understand ourselves a little better, because understanding ourselves is the only way we can love, and it's the only way we can educate our children. If we understand clearly, because there are a lot of proposals about what is man and what is the meaning of humanity. And of course, the church has its, that is joined to the proposal of, in some parts of the Greeks, so, and it's a proposal that is founded in the love of God and in the plan of God. But it's rational, because the plan of God is creation, and God has given us an understanding for knowing what is his plan and living it. Not something that I need faith for understanding what is a human. I need faith for believing in the mystery of the love of God and that he has given his son Jesus for me. That for that, I need faith. For understanding the plan of God in my life, I don't need faith. When the cross comes, yes, I need faith for keeping in the plan of God, but not for understanding it. So, our dignity, our equality in rights and dignity is founded in the truth of our humanity. So what is what we are going to try to understand a little better? We are going to pass this to another position that is more... What are the main constitutive and permanent experiences of the human person? The things that you have always with you that is, show you your humanity. And so we don't mistake, because we have a strong tendency to don't leave our humanity. And the first, you will be surprised. We are our body. And that is the first statement that is very important, because we have a strong tendency to live in our minds. That is the reason we have so many problems, because majority of us are living in our minds, not in our body. And God has given you a body for what? For living in your mind. What a crazy thing, no? A person who is infinite in wisdom has given us a body for living in our mind. All neurotic behaviors are coming from living in the mind. Or your anguish, anxiety, fears, unbalance, and sins are coming because you are living in your mind, as me. To live out of the mind and to live in the body, you need love for that. And it's not so easy. Children usually live in their body. That's the reason they are so happy. Because they don't worry. They are not thinking what they have to resolve. But we have a strong tendency to try to escape to our bodies, because it's the way we escape from reality. Because I mean, do you have, can you say me something that is not your body? Do you know something about yourself or about any person that you know that is not about his body or her body? If you say it, I would like to know, because I don't know nothing. What I know about you and everyone, people I know, my father, my mother, and my brothers, is what they revealed me through their body. So it's important. God has given us five windows for being out and receiving reality inside us that are the senses. We have five senses for keeping ourselves on reality, not for keeping ourselves thinking. You can know the measure of your fear is the quantity of thinking you have in your life. So you can, when you go out from, and nothing is nothing. The only thing that you can control is yourself, but you're not taking care of that. Of what? Controlling yourself, of being a person, or growing. That is in your power. That is the only thing that is in your power. When that is, you are not taking care of that, Of course, you are trying to control the future, and you are going to the past for nostalgia, or whatever you say, how you say in English, for the things that are past, and now, the past, you are killing yourself in that moment, because you are creating a kind of cold thing, depression, because every time you go to the past, you are going to be more sad. Every time you are going to the future, you are going to be with more anguish, more anxiety, and more fear. And you are choosing that. It's not that that is the way you are made. No, it's the way you are choosing because you don't want to accept yourself. You don't want to accept your reality, or me, I mean. Because that is not an easy problem. It's a problem of trust, of humility, and that's our virtues, and we don't have them. Because this is the goal of this. Self-determination means the choices I make about myself. You know, it's because sometimes we think in freedom like something that is for other things. Freedom is for building yourself. If you are not aware of this, when you wake up in the morning, your day is going to be an empty day. Why? Because freedom is for building yourself. It's easy. And when you are not teaching that to your children, or how you is going to work your marriage, if you understand that this is the meaning of your marriage. What? To help your husband to build himself, to help you to through your love, to help your wife to build her. When you are not there, you are in your thoughts, trying to control things that you don't control. And how can you teach your children? How can you help your children? Put in rules. Life is not about rules. Life is about love. But love means that I love myself in such a way that I want the fullness of my existence. I want to achieve it. But the only way of achieving your fullness is your action. If you think that you are going to find some fullness out of your action, you can continue thinking, because it's the only thing that a person can do, thinking. Because reality is the foundation of everything. And when you are not in reality, you are in your thoughts. And that, I repeat, becomes sometimes a neurotic behavior. That is living in my mind, instead of living on reality. We can test ourselves, looking how things are working. We will see now the first point, how much we can. And now we have a little moment for discussion. You can talk about, and if you want to make questions or difficulties or something that Father Armando is saying that is not clear, that probably are a lot of things. Because the meaning of this is, you are called to fullness. Use the instruments God has given you for your fullness. Because that means to be human. You can destroy your humanity, or you can make your humanity a place of joy and fullness.
Okay, so I just want to take a minute to ask, does anybody have any questions for Father Armando, or need clarification on anything that he's spoken about so far? I know it can be a lot. Talking about what it is to be human is kind of a broad subject.
I'm going to put it out there. So, when's your book coming out?
What's going on?
My question is, you didn't mention the soul in the whole conversation. And
because you don't have an experience of, yes, go ahead.
Okay, wait, let him ask him.
Well, so as I was listening to you, I recall a recent controversy about some misrepresentation of the Pope's words and the claims in the press that animals, you'll see them in heaven because they have souls too. So as you were talking about experiencing life through relationships, right, animals can do that. But that's my question for you is not, does my dog have a soul? My question for you is, where does the soul enter into this conversation, and where do you get to that?
Thank you. The soul is in your body. Your body is reflecting a soul. You have face, and your face is your interior life. Because I don't want to talk about the soul as something that is inside us. That doesn't exist. We are a reality that is only one reality. The majority of the problems in human history and philosophy is the separation between the soul and the body. Beginning with Descartes, that did that. There are two substances, the soul and the body. The body is mechanical, and the soul is the spiritual part. That is, for Christians, it's an heresy. For understanding, it's a stupid thing. But Buddhism is there, Gnosticism is there, Theosophy is there, and I want to make confusion. You, in all these things that I am saying, is reflecting your soul, because your soul have two dimensions. First is intelligence, and the self-knowledge that I have of myself, that is the second dimension. You are always aware of yourself. That is something that is showing your soul always. Why? Because you are aware. If I say to you, look to Daniel, what do you see? A girl, a body, a person, hair, face, legs, arms. Okay. Now I say, look to him. And what do you see? The same difference. He's a male and a body. But if I ask Daniel what she was saying, what I was saying, that is very different. She was experiencing herself looked by the others. And that is your interior life. You don't see yourself. It's a mystery. But you live from inside. And everything you have is inside you. You don't see your body. You experience your body interiorly, in relationship with others, in the feelings you have, in the emotions you have. When somebody talks to you, you are experiencing something. So the mystery of yourself, I repeat, you are only your body, but your body at the same time has an interior dimension that is always with you, that is this dimension. It has many kind words for using that: self-consciousness, self-awareness, interiority, subjectivity, interior life, the heart, have many ways. But that is manifesting me always, that I have a soul. And the same thing that the freedom. Freedom is something that is self-determination. When I understand freedom in this way, I understand that I have a spiritual dimension always. Because it's not something that I am ruling. It's something that is talking to me about what kind of person I am becoming. So my person is in my hands. And from there I am understanding that I have a dimension that the animals don't have. Even the animals have a kind of soul. We can talk about that, because Aristotle talked about that. And it's a discussion that has to be discussed. It's not a spiritual soul, it's a material soul that dies with the body, but because our soul is spiritual. And that makes a difference, because we have this dimension in us. That if the animals are going to be in hell, that is another problem that I am not going to argue here. Because I don't know, maybe, if heaven is a new earth and a new heaven, and there will be all the joys that we have here in superabundance, because it's a banquet, maybe animals, if we eat in a banquet, maybe they have winged eggs or whatever for eating, no? For making the cakes there in the banquet. I don't know about that more, because the Bible doesn't say, but what I know is that all these dimensions are teaching us that we have a spiritual dimension, a soul inside us. Because it's our mystery. I don't want to talk directly by the soul, because it seems that it's something that is separated from my body. I have an expression here that we would don't arrive there, that is, living in the spirit is living in the body. The contrary of living in the spirit is living in the mind. It's not living in the body. When St. Paul talks about living in the flesh, it's living in the mind. It's living in the ego, in the psychological level of the ego of the person who is trying to escape from things and is suffering a lot because he's empty, lonely, despair, disappointed, frustrated, with impatience, with aggressive, with lust, with envy, with jealousy, judgmental, and all these things are coming from the mind. A person who is living in the body is a person who is in fullness always, because the Holy Spirit can work through that person. Living in reality and living in the body is the same thing, because what is the body doing with me now? It's putting me here and now, in reality. Because my senses are about here now. I mean, that means that I don't need to think, no? We need to think, but controlling what I am doing. Not letting my thoughts to go back and forward to the past and to the future. Because I repeat, that is neurotic behavior in the concrete way. Neurotic behavior means that I am suffering. It's not that I am a person that has a compulsive tic that is, no. Neurotic behavior means that I am not having joy, peace, and fullness in my heart. Because I am called to live in that way. But I can only live in that way if I am here. So all these six dimensions are showing us that we find a spiritual. I was talking at the beginning of the deeper of the relationship. The deeper of our being is our soul. And from there we can make relationship. If you are not, many people are superficial and also artificial because they are living outside. A person who is living from inside, and that is the mystery of the woman at the same time. Why? The mystery of the woman is the interiority, is what she has to reveal to the man. That's the problem of this society. Women have a very little interior life, and the problem is that not are bringing men to their understanding of themselves. Because from the beginning, God gave the woman to the man for understanding the man himself. This is flesh of my flesh and bone of my bone. And the moment he understands what was the meaning of his being, how? To the woman. So the woman who is losing that interior life, that means, because it's very difficult to understand, I am in solitude. This is your relationship with God, your interior life. God is giving it to you in love. The problem is that because we are escaping from our interior life, we are escaping from God at the same time. It's the same thing, it's no difference. Your beauty, your preciousness, your uniqueness, your mystery, your person, your interior life, and your humanity. And God is giving that to you that the animals don't have, for you build a kind of person that is calling to be more than you can desire and want. In religious language, it's a saint called. In human language, it's called a human, a person who achieved the fullness of his humanity. But that depends on how I am using, how I am accepting my interior life, understanding that these two are totally connected. They have a capacity of building myself. And I exist only for that. In the moment you are not there, your life has no meaning. You can ask, and that's the reason you can talk about among you and talk about what is the meaning of your life. Any money, sex, my body, I mean, my family, even. My family for what? For escaping from my loneliness. Your family is for building yourself and helping the others to build themselves. How? In the way you love them. But that we are again in the same question. Each of my family has this interior life, and each of the members of my family has this freedom. So my way I help them and I grow as a family is working these dimensions in the person. When I'm not working that, my family is a place for escaping from my loneliness, as is for majority of people. And they are not growing in their families. What? In the experience of fullness. That is for what a family is, in those relationships that are created for helping each other to grow in love. But that depends, again, we go to the same problem. Living in the present, taking care of the interior life of the people, of the heart, if you want, and understanding that he, she has a freedom, I am not responsible of her, his action. I'm responsible of my action, and when my children are little, from the actions of them. And I need to help them to understand that their actions have always an effect in them. They have a consequence in them. They want or they don't want, it's not a matter of what they want, it's a matter of how is life. Because we are created for building ourselves through our actions. And when we are not there, we are totally lost in being humans, I mean. The plan of God of salvation is that we restore this when we think, what, for what is mass? For what is confession? For what is for restoring the human. Because God is the creator and he wants for us a fullness. The problem is that we continue being in our mind, in our thoughts, and in our ways of living that are sometimes crazy and destructive. Or what? On my relationship with my wife, with my husband, and with my children. And I am not living showing them that there is a fullness in life. What fullness? The fullness that comes from your actions. I mean, so simple as that. Not more difficult, because the plan of God is not difficult, it's very easy. We make the question. Do you have anyone any other question? I know. Or you can talk in the tables, what do you think about, and if you get out some questions from the dialogue, we can make it in how much? 10 minutes? Yeah. 10 minutes for talking about what we have been talking. Thank you. First thing, if you want now to ask something or to talk about what you were talking in your group, or say to the others, so. You want to say something?
No. We were talking about St. Therese and Mother Teresa and how they were able to live with humility in the moment, in their bodies. I think it was Mother Teresa said that if at a given moment you are supposed to be scrubbing a toilet, that is something you should do with absolute joy, because God loves you and you are there, present in your body, scrubbing the toilet. And St. Therese, in her little way, she wanted to be a missionary, never got to do that, but she learned that every little thing she did was fulfilling God's will for her.
Yes, we don't talk about that, but the only way of being here now is understanding. There are two ways. One is the Buddhist way, that is very difficult. It means a lot of meditation, because you have to go away from reality in some way. And the other is the Christian way. It's understanding that you have a Father, that is infinite love, He has a providence for you, and His will is your best, and His will is being accomplished. There's a phrase of Saint Therese of the Child Jesus, the present moment is the will of God. I mean, the point is that we are little faith, and we sometimes, when suffering or trials or death is coming to life, where is God? Where is God? But that is the reason we need Jesus. Jesus has come for saying us, here is God, here is God. Where? In the cross, in the suffering, and in death, and even in our sins. So, what is there? Is the only way of living that in fullness is understanding that there is something greater than me, and my fullness depends on how I am opening myself to that beauty and love that is the action of God in our lives. But that means living as a child. It means restoring the original dimension of God, of being with trust, with confidence, not pretending to be what I am not, are all the qualities of a child that are naturally given when her parents love him. He doesn't need to do nothing. He's there, trustful, enjoying what is happening, and living the life in humility, not trying to be what he's not, understanding his dependence of the parents, of the love of his parents. It's true that the majority of psychological problems that we have is because our relationship with our parents are not so good. And we create interior coverings for protecting ourselves because we are not loved. And that is also a problem with relationship with God, because we think and we project our relationship with our parents in God. And that is very painful, because God is not our parents. God has given us a parent, a father and a mother, for they love us, and through their love we understand who is God, but it's not, they are not God. They represent and occupy the place of God for a while, until 12 years. That is the time God is giving you your children. To take care of them, because you are there for occupying the place of God. And that is good, it's amazing, it's a responsibility, it's a precious gift, but it's also a task and a responsibility that is really grave. Why? Because your children are not yours, are from Him. Yeah? He's the creator, you are procreator. You are cooperating with God with your children. That is the reason you're so important, that you open from 1 to 12 years, before 1 year, because the children are educated in the depth of their heart before 3 years. After 3 years, it's very difficult to do things, because you know, the process of a child is a process of independence. First it's in the womb, after it's nursing by the mother, after it's out of the arms of the mother, after it's walking, going, moving, talking, and all things are for becoming independent. So he can assume his life and walk by his steps, the way of love. I mean, you have a time, and it's the most powerful time that exists. It's from, because the heart of a child is totally malleable, it's totally ductile, something that you can form and mold according to you. If you are concerned about this thing, because if you are in your mind, you are losing your children, and they will not understand for what they are here. They understand it by themselves, but not because you are teaching them that. Some more. Yes?
I wanted to follow up on the question that he had before. Based on this explanation of the soul that you have given here, how does that fit with our Christian understanding that when we die, our bodies and soul are separated at least until the end of time.
That is precisely that is dead, that is the separation, the body of the soul. Because our soul is spiritual and is immortal in itself. So when we die, that is the reason our body, we give a different name, corpse in English. But in every language is that. The body stops being called the body for being called in another way, but it's not, it's the body because it are the remains of the person. But as you can understand, it's a process of time. If it is, for example, an explosion, the body totally disappears. So the process of corruption of the body is because the separation of the soul, who is given to the body unity, beauty, sense, meaning, movement, is the soul. In the moment of the dead, what is that separation, what means is that the body began to be ugly, corrupted, losing union, and losing everything that is being given by the principle of life to the body, that is the soul. I mean, is when we die, is that is the separation of the body and the soul that is dead, exactly. In the moment that, and that is the reason that the body is so essential for us, that the only doctrine in all human history that proclaims the value of the body is Christianism. The resurrection of the dead. Why? Because we are not a spirit that is full in a prison that is the body. That is a dualistic, stupid way of thinking. You are your body. And the way you live your body is the way you love. I will go further. The way you live your sexuality is the way you love. Your sexuality is the key theme of your life. Why? Because it's the way your body is calling you to love. The call to love is not in the air, it's in your sexuality. Because it's calling you to be a spouse and to be a father and a mother. And it's constantly calling you through sexuality to that. And the problem is there, that this body is the way I love, is the way I related to God, is the way everything. Out of the body you have no knowledge of anything. Even when you think in God, you have to think in some kind of body. If you think in Jesus, good, because he has thinking our body. And if you think in angels, you have to think in some kind of body, because you cannot understand nothing that is not material. You can make a understanding as an analogy. Understanding is this, but it's not this, it's more, it's different. And that is the symbolic and sacramental way of the liturgy. All the liturgy of the church is founded in the body. It's material things. It's the bread, it's the wine, it's the water, it's the movement, it's the music, it's the sounds, it's the smells of the incense. All, everything there is for trying to move our physical dimension to the spiritual dimension. Because we are sacramental realities. Your body is a symbol of what? Of your mystery as a person. Your body is revealing always your person to the others. You cannot hide. And there is a part of the body that is in some way exposing me to the others, but at the same time is letting me to go in relationship with the others. And that is all the majority of problems in psychology and in human relationships are about this. How I am giving my body to the others and how I am opening through my body to the others. Because the way you communicate, you go in communion with the others, is your body. Sometimes we are afraid, because we are not sure of ourselves. But the body is everything we have. The problem is, I repeat, my body is my person in the material dimension, in the manifestation, the revelation of the person is my body. I don't have any other way of revealing myself. Why? Because, you know, for a Christian person, it's everything. God created male and female from the beginning. And when we destroy the plan of God, he become man, took a body for saying, my plan is the body. And he resurrected on the flesh for saying, eternal life is with a body. I mean, it's all about the body. Christianism, Catholicism, it's all about the body. Why? Because it's everything. Other religions, I mean, other religions are very different. Because if I can, I am a Buddhist and I can reincarnate in several kinds of body, what means that? That I am a soul or a conscious that has nothing to do with my body, what are you without your body? I mean, even the Buddhists that is saying that.
I mean, he has to be in meditation all the day for being there, because in the moment he moves, he's in the body. I mean, it's not that I'm making a joke, it's true. It's a reality. You need to meditate a lot and keeping as a tree in a position of loto, for what? For escaping from reality. Because there are the two major problems in human life are two that they try to resolve. And I understand Buddha. What I understand is the Buddhist people. Why? Because Buddha was trying to resolve the problem of loneliness and the problem of fear to death. That are the two major problems in your life. Because you are going to die, and you know it, you deny it with your way of living, but you know it, and the other is your interior loneliness. You are always alone. Always is always. What you are thinking, what you are feeling is alone. You cannot escape from that. And you can make, as we make, especially more women, attachments. For what? For escaping from our loneliness and trying to escape, but you continue being alone. And when your attachment that you are creating is for escaping from your loneliness, these attachments are destroying the other person that is with you. That can be your husband or can be your children, no matter. Because you are not in a relationship of love. That is understanding the misery of the person from inside. And that is a big problem. And Buddha, what he tries is to conquer these two problems. How? First, say, no, I identify my conscious with the universal conscious. I am in total union. As you can understand, for that you need to be meditating all the day. Why? Because in the moment you give to that, you are harming your feet. And you are not everything, because this is different for you. You have to deny reality for being in that total unity of your conscious with the universe. You can only do that, I mean, in a position of loto and thinking. And the other is, in the moment I go in that position of meditation, transcendental meditation, I go inside me and I go away from my body. That is a mental issue also, because they don't go anywhere. The truth is there. I mean, in that moment, drag a knife to that man, and you will see how is he there. And so quickly, I mean, but they go out and they understand that in that moment they are experiencing death, so they have conquered it. But I understand him because he has not a God, he don't understand what was God, and in those times the religion were horrible. And if you go against the religion, they kill you. And so it's better to invent a philosophy for escaping, understanding reality in a way that they can have some joy, some peace. And I understand it very well, because they try to give in reality, they try to accept the reality, they try to accept what they are, the situations, and what is happening, and that gives some kind of calm and peace. Why? Because you are not trying to be what you are not. The only thing you have to be is that in that state of total union with everything. But the problem is that there cannot be love. Because if you are a chair, or you are the same as a tree, or the same as a cow, how you are going to love other as a person? I mean, the person is disappeared. The mystery of the person is disappeared, because the mystery of the person is revealed through the body. You can have a general compassion as they talk, but that is all. A general compassion that is nothing, because it's feeling me well with everything. And that is not love. Love is giving myself to the others until the moment of letting myself crucified by the others. That is one. That is very different, and it's through the body. Yeah? Even my body. I mean, that is a problem of love. Because it's a very problem of marriage. How I am giving myself to other person. I mean, what is there? Is the body is our unique reality that we know. That we have a soul. Yes, everything is manifesting. If you are attentive to your life, to your mystery, everything is revealing your mystery as a person. So you have a spiritual dimension, you have a soul. But it's not revealed by itself, it's revealed through the body. That's the point that I try to, that's the reason I was not talking directly about the soul. Because I mean, you pray as you leave your body. How do you create relations with anyone if it is not through your body? I mean, it's important because your body brings you to several realities that are not easy to accept. And the point is that we need love for accepting ourselves. And that is the reason of the spiritual life, that is the reason of working your life, your interior life, your relationship with God, and the relationship with your children. Because you cannot fulfill the heart of your children. And so they are going to have problems when they achieve puberty. Why? Because you are not bringing them to a real love that fulfills their hearts. That is the love of God. And the moment that you are not bringing them there, their life cannot accept loneliness and dependence. So the desire of being loved, the desire of being desired, rule their lives. And that becomes sexual affection to girls and boys. And nobody can escape from that. I mean, this is not about an idea. This is the problem of humanity. Because it's the very problem of love. And when I am not opening the heart of a person to love, through my love, and bringing them to a greater love that is capable of fulfilling their hearts, my children are going to have problems. Why? Because it is not a matter of ideas, it's a matter of love. And we are here for living from love. And you cannot live without love. And the reason when you are not living from the love of God, what happened? Not your children, you. That the desire of being appreciated, considered, take care of you, take on your name, your fame, your prestige, your success, your doing right and they recognize it, your intelligence is always there, putting you, or trying to put you above the others in rivalry, competence, with the competitiveness with the others, judgmental mind, getting upset about everything that is not according to your will. What is that? Your ego in the first place and the desire of exaltation yourself in the first place. And at the same time and at the same moment, the desire that people love me, appreciate me, want me, consider me, and that is the other movement of a selfish, childish, immature desire that is a desire of a child. When you were a child, it was very good that you had that desire with your parents. But when you are growing and you keep that desire in your heart, you are not growing. You cannot grow because the desire of being loved is ruling your life. And the only way you can resolve that desire is bringing it to God and living from the love of God, that is Christian life, and living as a child of God, living from the Holy Spirit, and from there, loving the others. Because out of there, it's impossible. It's not a matter of ideas. It's a matter of how we are made. You need love. And you are looking for it in everything you do. You are worried about your body, how if I am thin, if my body is nice, and you think 100 times during the day about that. Why? Because you are worried how the others are looking to you and how are desiring you. At least 100 times. I mean, why? Because all it's about, they love me, they appreciate me, they think that I have a good look, a nice body, and I mean, it's crazy, but we are there. And the problem is that there, you don't find any love. Why? Because it's impossible that the people love a person that is self-centered. And we have to change that. How? That is Christian life and this spiritual life. Open my heart to the love of God so I can live these things in fullness. Because it's my very humanity. I can live my interior life without fear in solitude. I can live aware that I am here for growing. And I can live in my body, not trying to live in my mind and going to the past and to the future and harming myself, harming my children, harming my husband, and harming my wife. That is what we are doing. Why? Because a person who is loving, living there is all about what they do to me. And if they look me with a face that is not nice, or they say me a word that is not, I keep it inside with grudge for a week, and depending 2 weeks, and depending 1 month, and depending 1 year or 2 years. That is the kind of selfishness the person has. The more selfish is the person, the more keep the things. I mean, but we are there. It's not a foreign, oh, how horrible, no. It's that God is there and he wants for you a fullness. But what I am trying to understand is that the problem of the fullness is the problem of the present moment. How I can live the present moment with calm, in peace, in joy, in understanding that it's only one way, humility. Understanding that I depend on the love of others. Is my Father, my Creator, and Almighty God. And there is peace. What is your choice? Again, we go to the same problem. Because God is not a magician, depend on you. So, with what do you finish? Kunta prayer, no? Okay. We can pray to God, our Father, asking Him to give us knowledge of His love. I mean, it's all about that. The knowledge of the love of God is looking to Jesus crucified. That is the way God, your Father, loved you, your Creator, who has an infinite providence for you and also for your family. So we can open our hearts to Him and that love can change our life because only love changes our lives. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. We pray, Mary, our Mother, to give us that humility. That is the truth. Humility, the only thing that strengthens is accepting the truth of ourselves before God and His love. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and in the hour of our death. Amen. And we're trying to go in our interior life. We have God there, all the saints, the great conversion, and they discover that God is indwelling in that interior life, in that heart that we have. We pray to Him, glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be, world without end. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Thank you very much, everyone. Have a good week.